When you don't go to Geico.com, car insurance can seem intense. Like breakup R&B intense.
I thought you said you loved the sweater that I got you. If you didn't, you could have told me.
Geico makes it easy. Just go to Geico.com anytime to update or check your policy without all the extra drama.
I even had a gift receipt.
Blog Talk Radio.
Awesome. I needed that to blow the cobwebs off. It's been a hell of a week. So Sex Pistols, God Save the Queen. Not the traditional version we Brits sing, but probably the best. A little bit of patriotism from Johnny Rotten and the boys now, who sadly now, I mean, after all these years, I mean, I saw them live 10 years ago. He now sells butter, would you believe? He does an advert for butter. So it's just totally sold out, which I think, in a way, is probably what he would have wanted. Maybe he's done it sort of, it's an anti-establishment sort of selling out. I don't know. Here we go. It's Thursday night again. Almost our Christmas show, which will be just the same as this, but maybe there's some Christmas. And to be honest, I hate Christmas music. So it's just one Christmas tune that I will actually listen to, and I may even just play that three times. So bar humbug and Merry Christmas to one and all. So hey, we've got a show. Oh, we've got a show. We've got CJ Roberts joining us this evening, New York Times USA Today best-selling author. I'm excited about that, and I know Xtina is especially excited. In fact, Xtina is so excited because you think CJ is a big hero. Xtina is so excited she started drinking early, which is kind of good. I think she's there. Are you there, Xtina?
I am, and I have an extra large glass of wine tonight too. Usually, I have this cute little, like this little tumbler of wine that I drink.
You just stuck a straw in the in the top of the bottle, haven't you?
Or are you swigging
it straight out the bottle?
Pretty much,
you know, yeah. It's, yeah. I was gonna. I think maybe next week, obviously because it's the I guess our Crimbo show. I might have a beer, but I thought one of us needs to remain sober for the. I know CJ, she's hit the line already. It's going to be a hell of a show. It's going to be great. I'm really looking forward to. We should do that. We should all get blind drunk and then do a show drunk. That'll be fun.
I will start the. That'll be great. I'd do that. And to clarify, we do not have a show next week. I did not schedule one because it was, too close to Christmas. We did that for Thanksgiving.
No, that's because Thanksgiving was on a Thursday. I'm gonna play my Christmas song at the end of tonight then. If you're gonna be miserable about it. Do you know, you don't tell me anything. I mean, listen, the listener's sat there. He's probably distraught. No, we didn't. You have not mentioned it. And if you have, I forgot.
Maybe
I wasn't listening or paying attention.
Oh, that happens to me so often.
That happens to me a hell of a lot.
Yeah. Are you listening to me? Did you hear me? Do you understand? Yes, of course. And inside, I'm like, I have no clue what you're saying.
It's sort of twofold. One, I mean, I said it was a technique I developed with my first wife. And with obviously having my daughter, my seven-year-old, you tune out, but really? No. She did not. Wow. Half the time, I don't know what she's on about, to be honest with you.
I had to
tune my ex-wife out because she just really just... Her voice used to physically hurt my ears.
That's awful.
That was terrible. And when she used to get upset, when she'd get annoyed with me, she'd raise it and she'd have this pitch, this specific pitch that physically hurt my ears. So.
And all the dogs in the neighborhood would be barking and howling. Right?
Oh, she was just a horrible person. Horrible. So how are you, my dear?
You know, I am good now. I had an interesting day, but I'm here and I'm in a great mood now that I can't wait to talk to CJ. So I'm excited about that. And, and I'm drinking my wine. So what could be better, right?
I can't think of anything that could be better, actually. Yeah. I really, I couldn't think of anything better. So what have you, professionally speaking, apart from, drinking a lot, what have you been up to this week?
I see you're on the spot now. You sure are. This is something we have not discussed before. I'm just
getting my own back. You've cancelled next week, so I'm getting my own back. I'm going to make your life miserable for the next 51 minutes.
I don't know. I have nothing. What do you have? You tell us what you have going on because my brain is not working.
Well, hey, I'm glad you asked. And I should have mentioned it from the off, and I forgot. And for the new format and everything in the new year, we have to mention that the show is brought to you by Hellbound Books, the newest name in horror and dark erotica and all things dark, et cetera, et cetera.
I had a commercial.
Yeah, my double bill Bizarro book is now available. It was available, so it hit the shelves yesterday. It's a double bill. The first is called Feeder, which is a sort of a darkly comedic look into the seedy world of feeders and gainers, which are people who purposely feed up people until they're morbidly obese. So it's a jolly adventure as well.
Yeah,
it's a jolly adventure. For anybody who has, I mean, I know our listeners probably read The Erotic Odyssey of Colton Forshay, they know I do have a penchant for grotesquely obese people. The other one is,
Elizabeth,
the other part of the double bill is called I Am Joe's Unwanted Penis. Which is a delightful homage to the old Reader's Digest series, I Am Joe's Body. Again, I guess most people are aware of that. If not, I've spent a lot of time writing something nobody knows about, which is a lovable parody of that and also the Bruce Jenner story. It tells the tale of a penis that was taken away. It was chopped off from a guy who decided he wanted to be a woman. And then he goes on an adventure to sort of be reunited with his person, and puts a tear in the eye. It does. It's kind of a sweet adventure story.
Yeah, with
body part. I mean, it's bizarro. It is darkly comedic. I mean, it is funny, and it's got a very, very well set up and executed Donald Trump joke. So if anybody wants in on that, buy the book. It's available on Amazon, paperback and Kindle, and shortly, I think it's available on Apple Word or whatever it's called, Apple Books, and Kobo and Nook as well. So, yeah. So there you go. Anybody interested in reading about a penis's adventure in the real world, then buy it. So, hey, we have, I know you're so excited. I know you're excited. I know you have all the books.
Which I do.
Is excellent. So I'm just going to sit back and let you let you fawn all over CJ, because obviously you're a big fan. stay away from mallets though. You know, no breaking her ankles with a mallet.
Oh.
See,
no,
young people won't get that reference.
You don't think so?
They won't get it. No, of course they won't. No, if it's anything filmed sort of before 2000, and they're just, it's old, A bit like, I guess, how we see the black and white movies of old,
Yeah.
Anywho, hopefully, it's becoming the catchphrase, AT&T willing, we have CJ on the line. Are you there, CJ?
I am here. I've been eavesdropping.
Oh, thank goodness for that. Thank goodness for that. Are you drunk as well, or is it just Xtina tonight?
Oh, no, I got started.
Excellent. I'll tell you, Xtina, I think she started just after breakfast, to be honest. I think she puts wine on her cornflakes, I'm told. And then, but without the cornflakes.
It was pretty funny, actually. Once I was at a book signing, and you got 80 writers there. We were all there for the signing, and I went, was there the night before in the bar, and it was just one bartender, and I said, are you going to have help tomorrow? And he said, one more person. I said, you're not prepared for what's about to happen in this place. And sure enough, 80 writers descended into that bar, and I mean, they were just out of things. They were just out.
Oh my goodness, that sounds fun.
It does. It really, really does.
I kind of felt sorry for the bartenders. I was like, oh my goodness. Oh, and then aside from the writers, then you had the readers go in there, and you just had a bar chock full of horny women and two bartenders.
Oh, man.
I bet they thought it was Christmas and birthday and Father's Day all right.
No, honestly, I don't think they've ever come as close to knowing what it's like to be a woman than that night.
Right. Awesome.
Wow.
So is this an annual thing? If it is, send me an invite.
Oh, no, there's several book signings a year, that people go to. But, yeah, I always feel bad for them. We also had one that got crashed one time. Some guys wandered in there, and of course I knew they weren't with the party because they were, they had outies. And I told them, I was like, if you guys can't pick up in this place, you can't pick up at all.
Yeah, it's just shooting fish in a barrel. Yeah, we oh, should, many years ago, I was a sales rep. And was away a lot, and it was sort of like, you know, the hotel lifestyle. And around Christmas, we used to do the, we'd book into like sort of a big like Ramada hotel down near London, and we would just crash all the office parties that were going, because, you know, after so long, nobody had noticed a couple more people, you know. And it was mm-hmm. fun. Although we crashed one, and it was a Scottish do, and all the guys apart from us three were in kilts. So we just stood out, seriously, like sore thumbs. It was we were asked to leave, I have to say. So we're with Tom. We're so great. Yeah, but all good stuff. So thank you for joining us. Is it CJ, or, you know, do we just call you C, or how does that work?
CJ works. My mom calls me CJ too. So
awesome. I'm going to have to ask, what is it short for?
I actually never tell anyone.
Yeah, oh, okay. I didn't even know the answer.
Mind your own business, either. Jim. Mind your own business.
Yeah,
okay.
Right?
yes, shut up.
It's kind of like, you know, it's like the purpose behind the pseudonym thing.
Right,
gotcha.
Right,
okay. Can we just forget I asked? We can edit that out. You're all right. Edit that
I
out
was
in post.
Say. Mm-hmm. I can't remember exactly. I remember I used to browse Amazon all the time for my next read, and Captive in the Dark popped up one time, and I one-clicked it, and I had it sitting on my Kindle for a really, really long time, and I have to tell you, the reason it took so long for me to start reading it was because I was a little scared. It was my first dark erotica kind of book, and I actually was scared. I seriously was. And when I finished the whole series, when I finished the epilogue book, it must have been, I think it was like 3:00 in the morning, and I get to the last part, and there's nobody around to talk to. I remember going, oh my God. And I was so upset. I actually went in and woke my mom up at like 3:00 in the morning, just because I had to tell her how
wow.
awesome. Yeah.
Oh, I bet she was pleased.
Well, I think I told her so much about the books that she didn't actually have to go in and read them herself. You know, I was that thorough. So
awesome. Yeah. That's brilliant. No, I'm impressed. That's great. That is great. That's,
I actually had to get them in paperback, so I have, you know, all the books in paperback too, and I think I've read the whole series twice, and I love Caleb. I do. I just love Caleb.
Aw, I love him.
So,
too.
I mean, I'm obviously, you know, I have an outie, as as CJ right? would put it, and I'm really sorry. I do apologize for having an outie. I was uninitiated, so. You know, tell us about it. Well, both of you. I mean, I think Xtina probably knows more about it than you do.
Oh, well, I don't know about that.
So, yeah, CJ, so what is the, you know, tell us about the inspiration and whatnot.
Well, I don't know. That's always one of those questions that you like it, but you also kind of hate it because there's nothing more, like, narcissistic or,
right.
Let me talk about that. And what motivates me? And no.
Sorry, shall we talk about something else? I mean,
no. No. I think we're here to talk about books, so let's do
no,
that.
No, we don't. No, hey, no. Come on, maybe, what about those fluffy kittens? I mean, you know, they're cute.
I love kittens. In fact, there's a kitten in my book.
I hate them. I don't like cats at all. They just look at you like you're dirt.
I actually don't. I never was a cat person.
Mm-hmm.
You know, until now, I think once you no longer need all of that, you know, jumping on you love, I think you're just like, great, you poop in the box.
Yeah.
Right? Appreciate it.
Awesome.
I actually got inspired to write it. It's kind of an unusual love story. I would say the inspiration for writing it first and foremost was that I couldn't find it anywhere to read.
Right.
I kind of had this story that I wanted to read, and I was looking around for it and couldn't find it. So I was like, I'm going to have to write this stupid thing myself.
I'm glad you did.
So I was in the military, and I got I was stationed in Germany, and my first night there, you know, I'm new to the country. I don't know anyone, don't have any phone, anything. And it was 11 o'clock at night. I was in my hotel room, and I wanted to go out because it was a Friday night, but I kept having this idea about getting kidnapped and raped and murdered. And so I didn't go anywhere, and instead I sat down to write about kidnapping and rape and murder.
Yeah,
and a whole host of other things.
I mean, I guess that's, you know, that's the writer's brain, you know. I mean, obviously as writers we get that. I mean, you know, you're non-writers. We should have a name for them, like obviously Harry Potter calls regular people muggles, but they don't get that, you know. I mean, for that's, yeah, fine, you're going to write about that. But, you know, it's the dark places that we go is... So they say, you know, on the surface of it, it's kind of scary. Kind of scary.
Right.
I mean,
well,
was there a particular reason for that? Was there a particular reason why your mind went there? Or is just off on its own little journey?
Oh,
well,
because I'm in a new country. You know, I'm in a
right,
new country.
Uh-huh.
I don't know anyone. I want to go out. but, you know, there's always... You know, and of course it had to turn up smutty because while I'm alone in my hotel room on a Friday night, you know, the mind wanders.
Of course, yes. Yeah.
So I think in the beginning, you know, if you're going to write anything, you have to start from a place of truth, which is, you know, if you're going to write something scary, you have to write about something that scares you, right? I mean,
yes,
right.
Yeah.
And, you know, so started there. And like I said, and of course, because I'm writing this for myself, I have to make it the best plausible scenario, which is that, you know, my human trafficker is ridiculously good looking.
Yeah, I know. Do you know, I remember actually when I was reading, making teasers and stuff and a Dreamcast and everything for the books. And let me think, what is that guy's name? The dude who plays... the Sons of Anarchy dude. What's his name? Oh, Charlie Hunnam, right? Is that
Charlie Hunnam?
Yeah. Yes, that's who. Was that your Dreamcast pick for him, or was that just mine? Because I'm not sure anymore.
Yeah, that was pretty funny. Because when I started writing it, I didn't have anybody specific in mind. I was just writing.
Mm-hmm.
But then, you know, later people had asked me, you know, who would play him or whatever, and I remember he was. I saw this picture online of, like, a model, whatever, and anyway, I saw Charlie Hunnam, and I thought Charlie Hunnam looked a lot like that model, and I was like, you know, Charlie Hunnam would be a great pick for this.
Yeah.
And then the other guy ended up being the model that I was thinking about before, ended up being Travis Fimmel, who now plays the lead in Vikings and could be Charlie Hunnam's brother. I mean...
Oh, wow. I don't know him. I'm going to have to look him up.
Oh, yeah, you're going to have to look it up.
Yeah.
But, I think my story is just, I kind of try to, I gloss over things, I make light, I make a lot of jokes, but I think that with my work, I was really, ultimately, it was about self-discovery. All good writing comes from self-discovery, whether it's something that you're afraid of, that you want to conquer, or if you're just kind of like working out demons of your own.
Right.
So I always say that in the book, both the characters are sort of parts of me, you know, everybody has that duality, the side of you that is kind and compassionate and has empathy and is a good person. And then, of course, you have that other side of you, which is, you know, completely id and can be ruthless and sinister and just god awful to people. So I think I wanted to explore that. I started writing it when I was like 22, I want to say, 21, 22. So I was learning a lot about myself at the time. And so I always say that the female character is not only that more vulnerable side of me, the part that was kind of learning to be a woman, you know. And then the male character just kind of allowed me to... explore that darker side of myself. So, and of course, it's all fiction, so That works.
Yeah. It's good. I was gonna.
That's huge. I'm always arguing that with people.
Well, I think that whenever you have a really good story, a really good book, I think that there are times that, you know, you turn the last page and you're like, wow, that was so real. And it does make you wonder, how can the author tell a story and tell it and evoke such feelings from you? And I think you do wonder sometimes, you know, is any of this real? You know, I've definitely run across a lot of books where I've wondered, you know, because they do say that you write what you know. But, you know,
right.
I write about killing, you know. So.
But even still, that's inside everybody, right? I don't know anybody that's never thought to themselves, like, I wish I could kill that person if I could get away with it.
Right.
We're back to my ex-wife again.
Right? Oh, look at you. Terrible.
You've met her.
You know what?
Lovely lady.
I try to remind myself for that every time, like every person that I've thought that about, there's also someone who has thought that very same thing about me.
I think we all have.
I think
as you get older as well, you sort of collect these people.
I don't agree. I don't agree with that. But I was going to say,
I bet you could rustle up a few people, Xtina, to be honest.
Hey, now.
If you really thought about it, I'm sure there's probably a couple of people out there who'd like to do you in, to be honest. I'm just guessing.
I'm
waiting
for you to burst
into
a personal story.
I think if you go through life, a good friend of mine, his grandfather long passed away. He had a great Yorkshire saying. He said, "Friends come and go, but a good enemy will last you a lifetime."
oh my God!
Which
you
is
know,
great.
You have to have an enemy.
Yes. Yeah. I mean,
if
you know,
you have
you,
a nemesis,
I think
you're missing out.
I think if you've gone through life, you know, at least to a certain point, without having somebody somewhere hating you, you've probably not done it properly.
Yeah,
I'm actually pretty lucky because my nemesis is myself, so we have ourselves a good old time.
Awesome.
That is one thing.
To be fair,
I think.
Sorry, I was thinking you hit the nail on the head. Maybe it's part of the writer's condition. You know, my biggest enemy is me. And I think when you start having, you know, you throw in the, you know, the self-doubt that comes with the job and the over-criticism and, yeah, I think all of us can identify with that one.
And that's another one thing I wanted to bring up with your character, Livy. I loved that she was such a badass. You know, I read other sort of captive kind of stories, and you know the female lead is so submissive and sweet and innocent, and you know even Livy was a badass. You know, and I loved that about her. I did. I thought she was a great character, and that is one thing that I look for when I'm reading a book. I call it I hate the wishy-washy, weak females, and she was definitely not one of them. So
I appreciate that a lot, actually, because I go back and forth sometimes because, you know, you try to write it realistically as possible. And when I was writing it, it's really tempting to be an ultra badass, you know what I mean? Like,
mm-hmm. Yeah.
I don't know, like the Matrix or something. But most people are really not like that. So with my character, who is a young woman, and put in this situation, I really thought hard about, like, oh my gosh, you know, how would I feel in this insurmountable situation? And the truth is, I'd be totally just crapping my pants, you know.
Right. I'm right there with you.
And so you have to have these moments where you feel completely helpless and then kind of rally from that because that's what happens. You know, so I didn't make her so, you know, she didn't have all the answers right away. She didn't, you know, she wasn't like smarter than everyone you've ever met. And
right.
You know, stuff like that. I tried to keep it as realistic as far as, you know, things you might do and the intelligence you might have and the things you might honestly try, things that you might have seen on TV or, you know. So, in that way, I was kind of useful as a tool because I'm like, what the hell would I do? I don't know.
Right. I'm more the deer caught in the headlights. So I would freeze and, you know, then be dead probably. So.
I just like heroines don't rally. Like I, that's one reason I never got into that show. I never got into Weeds.
I loved Weeds.
Oranges. I know, but the female, she's so neurotic. I'm like, she should have died like 12 times.
There was many times I hated Nancy, the chick, but I still liked the show, you know. But there were many times I was like, man, she's done so many things that I just, I don't like her, but I did like the show. And you were going to mention Orange is the New Black. I don't know. I watched a couple seasons, and I read the book by the Piper, whatever. What was her name? I can't remember her name now.
Piper sounds right, but I can't remember the last.
Yeah. Like, I read her book, and it was different, and it was good. But, again, there's so many times that she does something that I'm just like, I don't know if I like her as a person, you know? And when I watch a TV show, I want to connect with them. I want to like them, you know? So that definitely made it weird for me.
Yeah.
I wanted to bring up Tears of Tess because I think I had the Dark Duet series at the same time that I had the Monsters in the Dark, and I read the Dark Duet first. And usually, whatever you read first, that's always going to be your favorite. So I have to say that Caleb and Livy will always hold like a special spot in my heart. But did you read Tears of Tess? Because that was probably my second captive story. And since then, I'm a sucker for the whole captive thing. I really am. I love them.
Pepper Winters, right?
Yes. Yeah, we had her on the show a couple months ago, and she's so lovely. And that accent. Yeah. She's such a cute accent. But, I loved the Monsters in the Dark series as well. And that's what I was wondering. Who do you read?
Who do I read? I purchase a lot of things. But my big main genres that I actually read are, like, I read a lot of manga and a lot of, sci-fi and a lot of fan fiction, too. But as far as some of the authors that we will, I like Will Pepper, obviously, and then I like Colleen Hoover, Taryn Fisher. I made a lot of friends, so I read a lot of my friend stuff, like Tara Civics, right. And Jay Sterling. And it's kind of interesting that I read them because I was never much into YA before because I just didn't feel like it took me to any boundaries. But meeting so many people in the writing community has kind of really branched me out,
Yeah.
Because really, the stuff that I would read is, and plus I don't read a lot of, MM romances and fiction, stuff like that. So.
Right. Speaking of that, what was that? Determined to Obey? Was that what it was called? Is that the one?
Yes.
I love that cover, by the way.
That was a hard spot cover.
Yeah.
Yeah, we went back and forth so many times. So I'm glad that you liked it.
No, and even Captive in the Dark, that cover, I think that was one of when I was hesitant to start reading Captive in the Dark, seeing the cover and I just, I seriously was scared. But I will tell everybody out there, read it. It's an awesome book, and you will fall in love with the characters and I don't know. It was amazing. I loved it. So.
Have you read? Do you like paranormal stuff?
Sometimes. It depends on the kind of mood I'm in. Yeah.
Well, if you haven't yet, you might want to try Kaya Bennett.
Uh huh. I don't think I've ever heard of her.
Yeah. No. I love her. She's my spirit animal. So.
Now, what kind of paranormal does she write?
Well, she just had a paranormal release. It's called Die by the Drop. And that's a really dark one. But, you know, she writes dark stuff, which I really enjoy. I enjoy books where people are going to make you question something about yourself.
Right.
I don't know, because I guess that's, that's my, if I had a kink, I suppose that would be it.
The dark, yeah, I like it.
Well, not so much the dark stuff, but, I mean, the learning something new about myself, whatever that is.
Yeah, being aware. I have to work on this. Well, it looks like we have to take a short little commercial break, or as James would call it, he has to take his wee break. So, yeah.
Go wee!
And I think
it's
we're
my age, you know. It's my age.
Yeah.
I'm a slave to my bladder. You know that.
So don't go anywhere, okay?
Okay, I won't go anywhere.
Well, me, I need to go. I need to go somewhere. So, yeah, we'll play a short tune. We'll be back in 2 minutes and 19 seconds.
2 minutes.
Found my thrill on Blueberry Hill. On Blueberry Hill, when I found you, the moon stood still. On Blueberry Hill, but all of those vows you made were never to be. Oh, we're apart. You couldn't be still, for you were my thrill.
Song about a hill. Strange things to to write a song about, I guess. But that reminds me, we've not had a flying visit from the president-elect tonight.
Grab him by the pussy.
Do you know that never gets old, does it? It never gets old. I'm going to do that. Pardon me, Xtina. For as long as that man is in power, I'm going to play that every damn week.
You have way too much fun with that. You really do.
you ain't seen nothing yet. To paraphrase the great Al Jolson. I got all sorts of fun and games planned for our new extended show in the new year. I've sort of been fiddling around with like, I had too much time on my hands. That's the problem. That is the problem. You know, so the devil makes work for idle hands and whatnot. But hey, it'll be fun. It'll be entertaining for our listener. Bless him, as long as he doesn't pass away quietly over Christmas. So let's fingers crossed for that one.
I think you mentioned something about dead. hookers or dead hookers in the hotel room last week or something, didn't you?
quite possibly. Yeah, that sounds like something I'd say.
Yes.
Yeah. Hopefully CJ is back. Are you there, CJ? Are you still with us?
I am here. I have refreshed my beverage.
Coincidentally, I just got rid of mine, so too much information. I'm sorry. I don't have boundaries. I think that's my problem.
If you'd read my book, you know I don't have boundaries or no.
Right.
Oh, then in that I am gonna have to read the book. Definitely. Now you've said that.
Well,
I hate
anyway.
Boundaries.
To be honest,
my one and only, and again, I apologize if this is insulting to yourself, you know, my one and only foray into the, the erotic romance genre, and anybody, our listener will remember, I've mentioned this before, was 50 Shades of Grey. And I read it, A, because it was a bestseller, and obviously as a writer, professionally
right.
wanted to see what made
you
it a bestseller.
You read it for the same reason that I read Twilight at first.
Yeah,
right.
For professional reasons. Yeah.
Right, everyone's reading it. You gotta know what's going on.
Oh, dear me. I've just plowed through all the Twilight movies because my daughter wanted to see them, and they were all right. They were entertaining enough, but seriously, glittery vampires. That's about the werewolves should have had their own show, to be honest. But yeah,
okay.
I mean, I think having read 50 Shades, I mean, literally slogged through it because I had to get to the end of it. And I'm glad I didn't
right.
buy all three like I'd originally planned to do. I kind of put me off that genre. I thought, well, this is a badly represented take on the BDSM community. Obviously, it was badly written. It was just bad. You mentioned before about having strong female characters. And what was her name? Anastasia or something?
Yeah.
She was just feet. But I mean, for goodness, really? Grow a pair, woman. Goodness sake.
Well, you know what?
One bite in my lip. Well, dear me. Sorry, I'm ranting. I do apologize. I'm ranting now. CJ,
no,
what were you saying?
No, it's good. It's good because you know what? There's always that disparity between how men will see a thing and how women will see a thing.
Mm-hmm.
So that's good. You should express yourself.
You know,
well,
Was I
talking while you were interrupting? I'm so sorry.
You were. You were.
How rude of me.
The only thing I wanted to say about about 50 Shades of Grey. I read all three books, and I did start reading them just because everybody was, and I wanted to see what the big deal was. I had heard that it was Twilight fan fiction, and I did like Twilight. I liked the movies. I liked the books. I mean, I did. So I was reading it, and I think I got halfway through it, and I was still waiting for Christian to bite her. You know, I mean, because I was thinking.
How did it relate? That's something. Is that an urban myth or is that true? I mean, how did it grow from Twilight fan fiction? There was not one vampire in it, or a werewolf.
You know, no, but still, it's got to be. It's real. It's true, isn't it, CJ? I mean, look at the characters. They're all the same characters. They just have different names, and they're not vampires. That's the only. It's my opinion, anyway. I mean,
well,
really?
No, that's like saying the Grinch that stole Christmas is the same as Dracula because they were the same characters. Only he wasn't a vampire. Well, seriously, how much have you been drinking? Dear me. Goodness sake, woman.
I'm not going to answer
goodness
that question.
I think for me, I mean, with 50 Shades, and I'm going to slate 50 Shades now because I really don't care anymore. But, I mean, back in England, we ran a couple of companies back in England. One, actually, we had involvement in the BDSM community. So we knew, subs and doms, we knew the scene well. And it was so far removed. I mean, the book would have stopped the minute she refused to sign the contract. There was no contract in place. Nothing would have happened.
Oh, yeah.
It would have been 400 pages of nothing.
Mm-hmm.
Well, the thing about 50 Shades, though, and the thing about writing in general, I don't know, and there'll be some debate on this, but I'm two beers in, so screw it. Let's have it out.
Excellent. Go for it.
Yeah. There's always this conversation about how responsible anybody is supposed to be, and I struggle with it, too, because on the one hand, I have a lot of things that run through my head, I don't know. I would not say that I'm anybody's role model, aside from the fact that my personal motto is pretty much don't be a butt, you know.
Right.
But aside from that, I don't feel like I'm anybody's role model. And I think with 50 Shades of Grey, you know, so it was fan fiction. So this is something that somebody wrote out of love for something else.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and I think why women identified with it was not only because we had the worst case of blue balls ever after reading Twilight. We were like, what the hell? I'd never read somebody fade to black in a book. Like, I was like, what the hell just happened? Why,
yeah.
Do I have pages missing?
Yeah.
Anyway. So of course, you know, E.L. went to her laptop and was like, this needs to happen. And, you know, 30-something women everywhere who were reading their kids' teen books were like, yes,
mm-hmm.
thank you. But I don't think that she had a responsibility to the BDSM community. I don't think that she was somebody that was involved in the BDSM community. I don't think that she was somebody that, like, knew a whole lot about this. She just happened to write something that she wrote out of love, and it turned out to be this breakaway hit,
right.
which is
yeah.
something that, you know, I can identify on a much, much smaller scale, you know, where I wrote, I wrote Captive in the Dark, and believe me, I was not sitting there thinking about what people were going to think of it, or about consent, or about rape culture, or about, you know, these huge societal issues. I mean, I was thinking about them, but they were very much in a back burner of my mind, because what I was exploring was not what was outside, but what was inside.
Right.
So it's always this conversation when you're talking about books like this where they'll point out, hey, that's not real BDSM, it's not this, it's not that. And I'm like, yeah, but she also didn't write a nonfiction book called, you know, How I Captured My Consensual BDSM Sex Life. I mean, that's
that would have been, I would have read that. That would have been great. I would have paid good money for that. I haven't seen the film. Definitely.
I think
yeah.
that's called Marriage, and the book would be titled How I Got Her to Give Up on Her Dreams.
Oh.
Oh,
ouch.
It's a burn. No, I'm kidding.
Ouch. I'm gonna back right off now because I'm scared.
We are gonna have to...
This is Revenge of the Feminists. It was an ordinary ovary.
There it was, the egg. It didn't come first.
So I wanted to ask you, because time is just getting away from us. Usually we have two guests on in an hour, and time is just flying by.
We need another hour just to bash 50 Shades of Grey. We've got another two books to bash, yeah.
No, I wanted to get back to Captive in the Dark, and I wanted CJ to read an excerpt for us. Do you have one ready?
Are you really going to have me read? Because I really get embarrassed reading stuff.
Oh, go make a read. Go on.
I'll read something, but I'll tell you this really quick story. So the first time that I ever had to do a public reading of my own work was at this. We had this little book festival thing, very, very small. So I live in a very conservative area, and I had to get drunk just to go. They call me up there. Right before me, there was a lady who was writing a Christian fantasy book.
Oh, God.
So right after her, I get called up to read. And let's just say that into a microphone in a very pin silent room full of Christian fiction readers, I had to use the P word twice.
Awesome.
And the C word once.
Nice.
And it was lovely. There was a woman who literally was fanning herself right in front
oh,
of
nice.
Me. Because
oh, I love that.
And
brilliant.
I was like, I'm a horrible person. I'm just...
You know, we had E.K. Blair on our show a couple of months ago, and she was like, I can't read my stuff. She goes, you know, I go to read it out loud, and I say thingy and doohickey. She's going...
No,
yeah.
You don't understand. When writers of smut... sit down to write this smut, we're literally like in our pajamas in a dark, lonely place full of shame. And that's how we get it on the paper.
No, you know what? That's funny that you say that because in one of our very, very, very early shows, I was asked to read one of my dark poems. And I said, sure. And I started reading it, and it had the C word in it. And, you know, I read it all the time. But I stumbled over actually saying it out loud. So.
Oh, yeah. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So, okay, so now say it for us.
I actually picked out, like, the very beginning, so it's not that.
Yeah.
But
we all
crazy.
Read it all, so it's okay if you curse. I mean, it is okay.
All right. Well, fine then. Talk. Pussy. Shit. All right, got that out of the way.
Let's go all that out of the way now before we start. I love it.
Right. I'm dying to say
that. I love
that.
It.
No. Okay.
You're okay. There's nobody listening. You're okay.
I'm in a jokey mood, and now I have to read this like serious material. Okay.
No. We don't do serious. It's life's too short for serious. So I mean, just read us a bit. Read us a bit. Go on.
Okay. All right. So this is chapter one from Captive in the Dark, and it's Caleb's point of view. Revenge, Caleb reminded himself. That was the purpose of all this. Revenge, 12 years in the planning and only a few months away in its execution. As a slave trainer, he had trained at least a score of girls. Some were willing, offering themselves as pleasure slaves to escape destitution, sacrificing freedom for security. Others came to him as the coerced daughters of impoverished farmers looking to offload their burden in exchange for a dowry. And some were the fourth or fifth wives of sheiks and bankers sent by their husbands to learn to satisfy their distinct appetites. But this particular slave, the one he eyed across the busy street, was different. She was neither willing nor coerced nor sent to him. She was pure conquest. After years of being the sole apprentice to Muhammad Rafiq, Caleb's reputation had slowly built, establishing him as a man both efficient and single-minded in whatever tasks were entrusted to him. He'd never failed, and now all those years had been spent preparing for this moment. The time had come to prove his worth to a man he owed everything to, as much as to himself. There was only one obstacle remaining between him and vengeance, the last true test of his soullessness, willfully stripping someone of their freedom. So I have more.
Oh,
that's my opener.
You're gonna stop there?
Just getting into that. I was just getting into that. I was just that's good.
Really?
They're beautifully read as well. Beautifully read.
Yes. Don't make me blush. It's embarrassing.
You said rude words. I was blushing before you said rude words.
He's lying.
Yeah. No.
So
I'm a sensitive little soul. You know that.
Yeah. I need to know what you're working on now. Like, what can we expect from you?
Oh God, I'm working on a book that'll probably never see the light of day. And if it does, it'll be banned immediately. I kind of got inspired to write a story about a set of twins. It's mm-hmm. about a blind sister and a deaf brother. It's called Trailer Park Eden, and it's basically incestuous blasphemy. Is that a thing?
Wow.
Interesting. Yeah, but you know, well, yeah, it is for me. It's kind of the relationship between the brother and sister. It starts out subtextual, but it's definitely all there, and it's not so. It's about when I say it's blasphemous, it's my version of kind of the collapse of innocence and just humanity, really.
Right.
So very dark piece of fiction.
Yeah.
Well, I'm enjoying it. I'm enjoying it very much. And I'm getting very metaphysical with it. because I know that there's going to be a whole lot of censorship, and I absolutely detest censorship, detest it. I mean, I really don't care what people are writing. I know that people say a lot of disgusting things, not just sexual things, but just, you know, insightful things, you know. And I hate that, but I would rather have those things in the world than the censorship.
Right.
So I'm writing this book, and I'm sitting here thinking to myself, it is absolutely going to get banned if I write this in the context in which I wanted to write it. So, in the same way that, you know, people made this big deal about 50 Shades of Grey, I hate to take it back there, but when it was vampires, people were totally cool with it. You know what
I
mean? It's like if you give people any excuse to abandon the morality, they'll do it. So I'm always looking for that. So I got very metaphysical with it in the sense that I'm kind of trying this whole parallel world thing.
Well, hopefully you will get it under the radar, and I will one-click it as quickly as I can, because it, you know, probably will get pulled. But if I click it really quick,
right after myself, people are like, "Look, people, it's going to be on sale from 12 to 12:04."
Yes.
So.
I was saying,
just stick it on your own website, and people can buy it. I mean, nobody's going to stop you by selling it off your own website. Or
right.
Yeah, there's ways and means. There's probably a whole underground movement for good uncensored books.
It's just hard to it's hard to make a career when you're one of those you know, niche or fringe writers. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Oh yeah.
Or when you're trying to write things that are outside of the formula.
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah, I know that one.
We are just about out of time, and this hour seriously flew by, and I want to ask you and put you on the spot, and will you please come back?
Yes,
we'll,
of course.
We'll have
a great time.
We have to have
quiet,
you back on.
No.
This has gone far too quickly.
No, James is going to give it to me. He's going to be like, "Look, I read your little book, and I have some problems. Number one, did you know that this was non-consensual?"
Oh, she has to read your book, your Erotic Odyssey of Colton Porsche. So.
I must. Yeah, if you make sure we get you, I will personally mail you a copy of Colton Porsche. I think you would enjoy it.
Yes,
right. But
if
you know,
pushing boundaries. It pushes some boundaries. I think you'd enjoy it.
That's right up my alley. But for your listener, because I always warn people. You know, I know it's really unusual to warn people off of your work, but here's the truth. I would rather have somebody that's ready for my work read my work and give me a great review than somebody who's not ready for my work read my work and leave me a bad review. So,
yeah,
you know, I always
sense.
Tell people,
yep.
This is not, it's not a romance. I didn't write a romance. I wrote a very gritty, very violent, very unorthodox love story. Or it's about a woman who has Stockholm syndrome, you decide.
Awesome.
yeah. But I always try to tell people that. I'm like, if you're looking for like some, you know, bad man with a heart of gold, this is not your guy. This is a bad man.
I thank you so much, CJ, for coming on, and I will definitely be talking more on Facebook to book you for another show. And thank you so much for coming.
Thank
I really
you.
Enjoyed it.
Yeah,
it's
sad that we have to go, but we do because our time's nearly up. And I'm determined to play at least a minute of my Christmas song because Xtina has ruined it for me by cancelling next
Absolutely.
Week.
Absolutely.
So,
we need the cheer.
You know,
we need the cheer.
I know. Well, Merry Christmas, and I hope we'll definitely see you again in the new year. That would be brilliant.
Absolutely.
Thank you.
Okay.
Right, quick,
before you go, CJ.
Yep.
So before you go, quick plug, what is your website so people can find you?
Oh, it's aboutcjroberts.com, where you can find
Perfect.
Out about CJ Roberts.
Yep.
Awesome.
Yep.
Brilliant. And on that note, we're going to go. Say goodnight, Xtina.
Goodnight, Xtina.
Goodnight, Xtina.
Okay. And goodnight, listener.
Goodnight, listener, wherever you are.
Goodnight, listener.
When you don't go to Geico.com, car insurance can seem intense. Like breakup R&B intense.
I thought you said you love a sweater that I got you. If you didn't, you could have told me.
Geico makes it easy. Just go to Geico.com anytime to update or check your policy without all the extra drama.
I even had a gift receipt.